Hello everyone, welcome back. Today we are focusing our energies on fiscal policy. So we have seen fiscal and monetary policy briefly in the aggregate demand, aggregate supply model, but today we'll focus more on fiscal policy. Now, fiscal policy can be expansionary or contractionary. And our first part of the chapter is focusing on discretionary fiscal policy. So when I say discretionary, it means deliberate changes in the use of taxes, transfers, or government purchases of goods and services. Any deliberate measures that change our taxes, transfers, or government purchases will shift our aggregate demand curve. So for example, if we have a recessionary output gap, so in this diagram, we are initially at E1, and at E1, we can see output is a lot lower than our potential level of GDP. In order to close the gap, we can use expansionary fiscal policy. So that would be increase in government spending or increase in transfers or decrease in taxes. In the case of inflationary output gaps, where your output is actually above our potential GDP, we can close the output gap by using contractionary fiscal policy, which will dampen aggregate demand, shift AD curve to the left, and thereby close this output gap. Contractionary fiscal policy would mean deliberate changes in our taxes. In this case, we can increase taxes, reduce transfers, or reduce the government purchases of goods and services. Now, remember again, these are discretionary measures, so deliberate changes in any of these three. Recall our discussion of the multiplier. The size of the shift in aggregate demand depends upon which fiscal policy tool is being used. If the tool is government purchases, our fiscal policy multiplier is 1 over 1 minus MPC. So any change in government spending will cause our overall real GDP to change by 1 over 1 minus MPC. And if MPC is less than 1, 1 over 1 minus MPC is typically bigger than 1. Giving you this amplified or multiplied effect on the overall economy. If the change is coming through taxes or transfers, now the multiplier is MPC over 1 minus MPC. And because MPC is always less than 1, tax and transfer multiplier is always smaller than the government spending multiplier. Again, a dollar change in our transfers is causing our real GDP to change by MPC over 1 minus MPC. Let's do an example over here to compare the effect of government spending or transfers on our real GDP. If my MPC is 0.8, my government spending multiplier is 5, and my tax or transfer multiplier is much smaller, and that would be 4 in this case. Let's assume we're increasing our government spending by $100 million. We know because of this $100 million, overall GDP will change by multiplier times the initial change in government spending, which is now 5 times 100 or $500 billion. A similar stimulus package, but now provided through reduction in taxes. So taxes are being reduced by $100 billion. Overall real GDP will now change by MPC over 1 minus MPC times this change in taxes. Recall that taxes will always have the opposite effect on your GDP. The reduction in taxes is in fact increasing real GDP by 4 times this amount, and we see GDP rising by $400 billion. As you can see, a much bigger impact on our real economy when the stimulus is coming through government purchases compared to when the stimulus is coming from reduction in taxes. Because whenever we have stimulus coming through taxes and transfers, a part of that stimulus is absorbed by household savings, and the full impact never enters the economy. Next, we are going to make the distinction between automatic stabilizers and discretionary fiscal policy. Discretionary fiscal policy was, remember, deliberate changes in our government spending, taxes, and transfers, whereas automatic stabilizers are referring to existing rules governing taxes and some transfers in your economy. The more progressive taxation system we have, or the more robust social safety nets we have in place, we see that the size of the fluctuations will be much smaller, and therefore stabilizing our economy. However, do not confuse this with closing the output gap. Automatic stabilizers do not close output gaps completely. They just make the size of the output gap relatively smaller compared to economies which do not have such rules already in place. In order to understand the role of automatic stabilizers, let's look at what happens if the economy is facing an inflationary output gap. So in my diagram over here, I've drawn an inflationary output gap where our short-run equilibrium GDP, Y1, is higher than our economy's potential. So if we have taxes and transfers already in place, let's see how will they impact the size of the business cycle fluctuation. So our initial E1 is when we assume there are no automatic stabilizers, the output gap is equal to the one shown over here. In an inflationary output gap, with your existing tax and transfers in place, we see that as income is going up, households are also paying more taxes. And at the same time, with more households earning higher income, transfers are automatically reduced because less people are now eligible for government safety nets. So taxes are automatically going up, transfers are automatically going down. Notice, what does it do to your disposable income? We know overall GDP is a lot higher, so this is obviously our dominant effect. But we do see some contractionary measures happening over here. Taxes are slightly higher, transfers are going down. And these two are your automatic stabilizers now coming into action. Higher taxes and reduction in transfers puts a negative pressure on your disposable income, does not offset this effect completely, but just put slight downward pressure. And with this downward pressure, we see consumption also slightly decreasing and thereby cause your aggregate demand to be going slightly down. So you can see with existing rules governing taxes and transfers, our output gap is not as large as it would have been in the absence of these rules governing taxes and transfers. So automatic stabilizers are automatically reducing our volatility in the business cycle. We can similarly look at a recessionary output gap and see how automatic stabilizers will again reduce these fluctuation in our GDP. So in my diagram over here, we are currently at equilibrium 1, which is a short-run equilibrium for our economy. Real GDP is below its potential, reflecting our recessionary output gap that we want to show. Now we want to see how will this recessionary output gap affect our automatic stabilizers. Note, whenever GDP is below potential, taxes are automatically going to go down. People are earning less income, therefore they are paying less taxes to the government. At the same time, with lower income or a big recession in place, we have now more people eligible for government handouts. So transfers are going to increase. Claims on unemployment insurance benefits are going to increase. More households are now going to be eligible for government income support programs. So transfers are automatically going to increase. So these are not changes in transfers or tax rules. These are your existing rules automatically taking into account that the economy is now in a recession. As a result of these changes, we see our overall disposable income, which was a lot lower because of the major recession, will see some positive effect. Households pay lower taxes and they're receiving higher transfers. So these two are the changes in your automatic stabilizers. These two, remember, are not offsetting this output gap entirely. They're just putting some positive pressure on your output gap. And with slightly higher disposable income because of reduction in taxes and higher transfers, households will increase their spending slightly, and therefore aggregate demand is stimulated. And as you can see, at equilibrium 2, automatic stabilizers have reduced the size of the output gap again. So we can conclude that business cycle fluctuations will always be smaller for economies which have robust automatic stabilizers already in place, compared to an economy which does not have these social security safety nets or a progressive tax system in place. Let's now look at the relationship between our budget balance and our fiscal policy. Budget balance is simply your taxes minus transfers minus government purchases, so income of the government in the form of tax receipts minus all of its spending. Now, note that all these three components of our budget balance are also tools of fiscal policy. Any changes in our discretionary fiscal policy will automatically affect our budget balance. So for example, if the government is using discretionary expansionary fiscal policy, it is going to reduce taxes, increase transfers, or increase government spend. These measures, you can see, are increasing government spending compared to its tax revenue, and therefore causing the public savings or budget balance to go into a deficit. Whereas a contractionary fiscal policy would do the exact opposite. We see taxes going up, transfers and government purchases are being reduced. Your public savings or budget balance sees an upward pressure, and your public savings are moving towards a surplus because now the government is earning more compared to its spending. Whenever a government announces a deficit, it's telling us that it's going to stimulate aggregate demand through these tools. Conversely, if you have a government which is aiming towards a budget surplus, we know that they will be contracting the economy because the tools are now working in the opposite direction. So intentional budget surpluses are synonymous to discretionary contractionary fiscal policy, whereas intentional deficits are synonymous with discretionary expansionary fiscal policy. Remember, whenever there is an output gap, it will automatically change our taxes and transfers. And as it automatically changes our taxes and transfers, it will automatically now put pressure on our budget balance. Do not confuse this phenomena with what we just did, which was deliberate changes in your fiscal policy affecting our budget balance. In order to understand this, let's assume the economy is facing an expansionary output gap. In an expansionary output gap, GDP is higher than potential, people are earning more, so taxes are automatically going up, and transfers are automatically reduced. And therefore, in your budget balance equation, government is relatively earning more compared to what it's spending. Note, nothing is happening to G because G is not an automatic stabilizer. So hence, whenever we are in a business cycle expansion, budget balance will start moving towards a surplus. Compound this effect with how government now responds to this expansionary gap. So the initial impact is coming because of the business cycle effect. And now government is trying to close this gap. Remember, whenever there is an expansionary output gap, government will try to close it through contractionary fiscal policy, which is again increasing taxes, reducing transfers, or reducing government spending, putting positive pressure on our public savings. So public savings will overall again increase. A part of the increase in public savings is coming from automatic stabilization. And if the government now closes the gap actively, it will further increase our public savings. The total effect is that our surpluses tend to become bigger during periods of economic expansions, or deficits tend to become smaller during periods of economic prosperity. Likewise, we can look at what happens to our public savings or budget balance if the economy is in a recession. So this is no deliberate changes in fiscal policy, only the automatic stabilizers will now respond. In a recession, because we are earning a lot less than our potential, tax receipts are automatically going to go down and transfers are automatically going to go up. So public savings are moving towards a deficit. If it's a surplus, it becomes smaller. If it was a balanced budget, it definitely moves towards a deficit. Add to this the response of the government in the face of a recessionary output gap. They would now use discretionary expansionary fiscal policy. So government will increase government purchases, it can increase transfers or reduce taxes, or a combination of all three. Note, any of these measures are putting further downward pressure on our public savings. So overall, we can conclude public savings are smaller during recessions, or deficits tend to become bigger during recessions. The effect on budget balance at any point can therefore be split into two parts: the effect coming from automatic stabilization and the effect coming from our discretionary fiscal policy. Cyclically adjusted budget balance is taking this distinction into account. It is simply the budget balance that assumes that the economy is at potential. So if the economy is at potential, the role of automatic stabilizers is now nullified. So cyclically adjusted budget balance is only focusing on the effect of discretionary measures on our public savings, because it's taking away the effect of our automatic stabilizers or business cycle effect on public savings. The cyclically adjusted budget balance is typically less volatile than the actual budget balance. In the last part of this chapter, we focus on long-run implications of fiscal policy. Now remember, the Keynesian multiplier or the Keynesian model told us that the increases in government spending during a major recession are not offset by your decline in private investment or crowding out. This is the much needed stimulus that we need that will bring the economy out of its downward spiral. However, if we keep on having persistent deficits, so that is one deficit after another, over longer periods of time, it can create problems for that economy. First one is, of course, the increase in our public debt. Deficit is the gap in spending compared to the government revenue, whereas our public debt is the accumulation of these deficits over time. So if we keep on running deficits over time, our public debt will become larger and larger. The higher the public debt, the more problematic it will be for the economy to pay off this debt in the future. In terms of rational expectations, we can expect the economy to increase taxes eventually in the future or for next generation in order to service this debt. Remember, if the economy is at potential and the government runs a deficit or runs consecutive deficits in this case, it will cause interest rates to go up. At higher interest rates, we saw in our loanable funds market that quantity demanded of loanable funds goes down, causing our investment to overall decrease. And this was referred to as our crowding out of private investment due to government running a deficit. Rising public debt is a major red flag also because it can lead to to sovereign default. This will result in, of course, economic and financial turmoil and a very politically and economically unstable environment. Now, the question that arises in the face of sovereign default is that why can't governments just print more money and pay off this debt? Because printing money is not as easy as it sounds. Whenever governments try to pay off their debt through printing more money, this is also referred to as monetizing their debt, it leads to inflation. And inflation, we have already seen, has its own economic, political, and social costs associated with it. And very high inflation rates is something that government and policymakers try to avoid at all costs. A widely used measure of fiscal health, especially used by IMF also, is your debt to GDP ratio. Now, debt to GDP ratio is simply your overall public debt divided by the GDP of this economy. Higher the debt to GDP ratio, lower is the fiscal health of this economy. However, if your accumulation of debt is being outpaced by your increases in GDP or growth in GDP, current deficits can be sustainable in the long run. Canada's current debt to GDP ratio is approximately 34%, and the median debt to GDP ratio for all countries out there is approximately 60%. Economists and researchers at the International Monetary Fund, which deals with a lot of sovereign debt, estimate that a prudential measure of debt to GDP ratio for developed economies is approximately 60%. It should not exceed that measure. And for developing economies or for emerging economies, their limit is actually quite lower. And this suggests that the debt to GDP ratio for such economies should not exceed 40%. Canada's debt to GDP ratio, as you can see, is still a lot lower than the limit suggested by IMF. However, it does not mean we should keep on running deficits, but at the same time, it suggests to us that given our current fiscal health, in the face of a major recession, Canadian government can run some successive deficits in order to bring the economy back to its path to recovery and still keep its long-run fiscal health sustainable. So that's the end of our discussion for fiscal policy. I hope you enjoyed it. I'll see you guys next time.